invite everyone to be upstanding as we begin our Mass today.
O Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the words thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy path throughout the universe displays. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy will fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Thank you, Norman, for leading this funeral mass for Kingsley Anthonisz. Thank you, Norman. Beautiful voice and a great tribute that he's been able to offer the family in singing that very classic Catholic hymn, How Great Thou Art. And as we come to commend Kingsley to our loving God, we gather to support the family, in particular Phyllis, his beloved wife of 53 years, I believe. Phyllis, we're here for you. And for Kingsley and Brian, the children and their grandchildren. Let's get this right. So we've got Tom, Ben and James, Toby, Sam and Ruby, the immediate family and the rest of us who are extended family. And friends, we gather to honour the life of Kingsley. My name is Andrew Jeckott, the parish priest here at St. Mary of the Cross Parish, which is the combined parishes of St. Bridget's, Mortyalex and Louis de Montfort's in Aspendale. There are so many of us here today. I will invite us now just to maybe turn to the people behind in front just to say good afternoon, maybe make a connection. We'll just take a moment to do that right now. Let's meet somebody we don't know and say hello. Yeah. Thank you. And many of us are of the Catholic faith. Those who are not, we're very honoured and privileged to have you present with us today. We begin with the sign of the cross in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. Thank you. So I invite us to be seated. And so our Mass today reminds us of the faith journey that Kingsley undertook in his life and the symbols of baptism we acknowledge at this time. So firstly, I invite Reg to come forward, a lifelong friend, and he will light the Paschal candle, the Easter candle that burns brightly at the foot of the cross. And again, a very important symbol, religious symbol of the light of Christ that dispels the darkness of death. Thank you, Reg. I invite us to respond to these parts of our Christian symbols. In baptism, our brother Kingsley received the light of Christ. This light has guided him through life. As we say together, may it now lead him into eternal life and peace. I invite Stephen to come forward to bless the coffin with the holy water. And as he does so, let's remember the many times that Kingsley has blessed us with his life. In sprinkling this holy water, we are reminded of our unity with Kingsley and each other through baptism. As we say together, may he now share eternal life with him in glory. Thank you. Thank you, Stephen. And lastly, the last Christian symbol is that of the pall, the baptismal pall. I invite Russell to come forward to place that on the coffin here today. We place this white cloth on Kingsley's coffin as a reminder of the white garment Kingsley received at his baptism. It is a sign of his Christian dignity. We say together, may Christ enfold him in his love and clothe him in bright glory. So they're just some symbols of Kingsley's spiritual life, but we know there's so much more to Kingsley's life, which will be captured in story, and that's when I will invite Kingsley and Brian to come forward to share some of those stories that capture some of their father's life in the eulogy. So I invite them to come forward at this point. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. So some of your jaws dropped a little bit because it's my father that passed away, not me. It's just some of you are getting confused with the name. I've had a few funny looks as I've walked around Aspendale the last couple of days. I first need to thank Father Andrew for allowing us, one, to use the church. It's been so much a part of our lives growing up, and for the incredible help he's been throughout the last few days, especially with Mum and getting things organised and helping everything to run so smoothly. It's been truly amazing. My special thanks. Brian's going to do a lot of the thank yous, but I have to thank Brian a lot. As I'll go through it, I was away while Dad passed away. We were away on holidays, and Brian's had to take a huge burden of the load while I've been away. He's done most of the heavy lifting and most of the work, and I'm forever grateful that he was able to do that. I'm really grateful that for everyone that's come here today. I'm humbled that Dad had such an influence on so many people's lives. Dad was a real larger-than-life kind of a person. He drew people towards him wherever he went. This was pretty clear in recent couple of days when Mum showed me all the emails that his friends from around the world have sent, talking about his achievements on the rugby field back in Sri Lanka. But even how back then he still drew people towards him, he had this ability to make everyone around him feel comfortable. The whole thing actually feels a little bit surreal to me at the moment. It's not how I envisioned my last few days with my father and how they would be. As some of you knew, he was a little bit unwell for the last 6 weeks. He'd been hospitalised with back pain, and he'd been moved to respite at TLC in Mordialloc, where he was recovering. And so I was able to spend quite a lot of time with him over the last 6 weeks. I spent most of my lunches with him over the last 6 weeks. And looking back, I'm really, really grateful that we were able to spend that time together. We really didn't talk about much. Sometimes we just sat in silence. I had my lunch. He was just sitting there just watching the telly. But our last lunch was the Thursday before I left for Vietnam on holidays with Vicky and the kids. He seemed in good spirits. We were talking about Vietnam, where he'd been to, and his memories of it. And I told him that I was going away and that I'd see him when I got back. Unfortunately, that didn't happen, and Dad passed suddenly but peacefully halfway through our holidays. I wasn't there to be with him when he left, but I am forever grateful that Mum and Brian and Faye and Reggie were there. We were able to be with him in his final moments, and they kept me informed the whole time through and kept me abreast of the situation, and I'm truly grateful. Especially thankful to Brian and Lucy, Faye and Reggie, Lorraine Russell, Stevo and Daniela, who've carried a lot of the load in supporting Mum while I've been away, especially Brian and Faye, who've been there constantly with her. Most of the organising while we were trying to get back, and so I truly appreciate it. Thanks to Vicky as well, because Vicky is always there to support me. She helps me through everything. She In the end, most of this eulogy was written while I was sitting in Ho Chi Minh Airport waiting for a plane to bring us back home. So I had a lot of time to think about different things that we went through, our times and memories together, things we shared as family and friends. And so I thought I was just going to want to go through some of my favourite memories, some of my things that I think influenced me in my life. So one of Dad's great loves was fishing. There's countless stories of the pictures of the big fish he caught while he was in Sri Lanka as a boy. But for me, one of my earliest memories as a family was going to Locksport with our cousins, surf fishing off the beach there, waking up early in the morning. But Dad liked all type of fishing, surf fishing, fishing off the pier in Mordialloc, catching bream in Paterson River, crabbing with the nets. He especially liked fishing with his cousins and his friends. And when they caught a big haul, the smile would take over his whole face. There's pictures of him everywhere where he's holding crabs or fish or... He was the one that knew how to clean the fish and how to, he never ate a lot of it, but he liked to clean it, he liked to catch it, and he was happiest when he was fishing. I was never much of a fisherman, but I still tie knots and set fishing lines away he taught me so many years ago. He loved gardening, and most of you would know that he loved his gardening. His garden was truly something to behold, and something he was very, very proud of. Veggies, fruits, ferns, flowers, he had a green thumb and could grow anything. Dad would spend hours in his garden pottering around and seemed to find endless joy and solace in a place that was very much his. The garden wasn't just for him. It was a place for everyone to relax and enjoy. He even at various times built tire swings off trees and even built a concrete cricket pitch in the backyard so Brian and I could play cricket on a surface that was similar to what we did. Loved and adored Mum. He was never a great displayer of outward affection, but he would show his love in many different ways. One way was to drag Brian and myself around shopping centres for hours on end whilst Mum shopped. Though he cared little about shopping, he was always patient and would sit through what seemed like hours or days to us while Mum shopped for various items on weekends. Both Mum and Dad were great entertainers. And if you would ask most people present what their clearest memory of Dad was, it would be his hospitality and generosity. Growing up, every weekend was filled with either going to parties or having parties at our house. My friends would often comment that my parents had a better social life than I did. If anyone came to visit, they would be hard up not accepting food or drink from Dad. He would basically badger them until they took something. Over time, most people found it easier to say yes rather than to say no. Our Christmas Eve parties were the strongest memories I have of growing up. Mum and Dad would have at times 150 plus people. School friends would line up each year to be given the honour of being Santa Claus for the younger kids. Christmas carols were sung at midnight. The older men and lots of our younger school friends would join in singing all sorts of old classics until the early hours of the morning. Dad was ever present, playing his spoons and making sure everyone was involved. This was one of Dad's great gifts, his ability to speak to anyone and draw them into a crowd. He was never shy about talking to total strangers or making sure everyone was on the dance floor. He could make anyone that was feeling uncomfortable totally at home. There's an old story, my memory kind of takes me, but my cousin Randall, who's here at the moment, we used to go to their place quite often, and there was a time, I think we were in our teens, I can't really remember, but Randall dressed up in a sari and dressed up as a girl sitting in a corner. And I think most people were in it except for Dad. And they just told Dad that this was his old cousin or an old friend that had come from Sri Lanka, and he was just sitting in a corner and she wouldn't talk to anybody and she was really scared. And Dad just made a beeline straight for her. Wanted to engage her, wanted to bring her in. And Randall just wouldn't talk because he knew that as soon as he talked, Dad would find out that was what was going on. And he kept the charade up for quite a long time until he finally had to talk because Dad kept pestering him. And then he realized, and I think he gave you a push and walked away. But he would definitely draw people in. He was a people pleaser. He would give the shirt off his back to anyone if he thought it would make them happy. However, his greatest love were his children and his grandchildren. In fact, Dad loved all children. I can't remember Dad ever missing a sporting event Brian or I were a part of. He loved his grandchildren and would spend hours just sitting with them. Some of the greatest memories for me looking back, and you'll see it in the photo board later, is how big a smile he has when he's playing with his children. It wasn't just his grandchildren, he loved all kids. In his last few weeks while we're in the aged care home, my nephew, Jack, who's very young, would come and visit. Dad would light up as soon as Jack came in the room, and he would seem like his old self again. I'm so grateful to Jack for giving that spark and joy back to Dad towards the end of his life. Talking to friends and family over the last couple of days, there are so many memories, it's hard to fit them all in. The last one that I just want to talk about was Dad's whistle. Everybody remembered Dad's whistle. He could whistle with a knuckle in his mouth, and it was the loudest whistle you could ever hear. You could hear it all the way down the street in Taronga Drive. Whenever we heard that whistle, we knew it was time to come home and we would rush back, and we would always find Dad just waiting for us in the front yard. Finally, I'd just like to read a poem. I saw this poem years and years ago, and I don't know why I kept it, but I did. And so I think it just encompasses Dad and everything I feel for him. It's called What Will Matter by Michael Josephson. Ready or not, someday it will all come to an end. There'll be no more sunrises, no minutes, hours or days. All the things you collected, whether treasured or forgotten, will pass to someone else. Your wealth, fame and temporal power will shrivel to irrelevance. It will not matter what you owned or what you were owed. Your grudges, resentments, frustrations and jealousies will finally disappear. So too, all your hopes, ambitions, plans and to-do lists will expire. The wins and losses that once seemed so important will fade away. It won't matter where you came from or what side of the track you lived on at the end. It won't matter whether you were beautiful or brilliant. Even your gender and skin colour will be irrelevant. So what will matter? How will the value of your days be measured? What will matter is not what you bought, but what you built. Not what you got, but what you gave. What will matter is not your success, but your significance. What will matter is not what you learnt, but what you taught. What will matter is every act of integrity, compassion, courage, or sacrifice that enriched, empowered, or encouraged others to emulate your example. What will matter is not your competence, but your character. What will matter is not how many people you knew, but how many will feel a lasting loss when you're gone. What will matter is not your memories. Life that matters doesn't happen by accident. It's not a matter of circumstance, but of choice. Choose to live a life. Bye, Dad. I know I didn't get the chance to say goodbye to you when you left, but I don't think you ever truly left us, as I'll always see you in a beautiful garden I walk past. If I see fishermen fishing on a pier, people partying and enjoying themselves, and in every child I see a smiling and laughing face.
Thanks, Kinga. I'll try not to repeat myself, Father, but thank you so much for having us here today. Thank you to the St. Louis Parish, all the kindness you've shown us in a difficult week. We really feel blessed that we can come back here. This was Dad's parish. We spent a lot of time here at Mass growing up. He loved the peaceful sort of serenity of this church. He helped, Pops helped, and I'll call him Dad. Dad helped and volunteered around the gardens, around these areas. Structures, he went to Working Bees, he did lots of sort of small things around this area peacefully and quietly in his way. He loved being part of this community, and he loved the achievements, and we just feel so blessed that we were fortunate enough to come back to our old school. I can even remember Pops and I, Dad and I used to, there was used to be horses in those school boundaries. We used to feed them in the day, 1,000 years ago, it feels like, but my first experience of animals. I've always loved animals since that time. So a warm welcome to everyone and to you all today. I mean, a very sad day, but hopefully a chance to celebrate and remember him happily. For however you knew him, he had 1,000 names, Pops, Kingsley, Chucky, Chucky Boy, Chuck, Cuckoo, to his close family, he would be so grateful that you're all here. As his names, and multiple of them there were, suggest he was everything to everyone. He never cared what you called him. He just wanted you there. I did have a look at King's speech about what matters, or the poem about what matters, and there's two lines that describe Dad pretty well. It's not what you got, but what you gave. It's not what you learned, but what you taught. I think Dad gave and taught more than most. Maybe he was, in his own clever way, he was smart. He figured out the simplicity of life pretty early. He never thought about receiving only what he could give. The irony was, the more he gave of himself and to others, the more people enjoyed him, shared with him, and listened to him. He got more of what he wanted and loved, which was people being happy around him. It was a pretty simple formula. The cycle continued for his whole life. And I think back, I don't think he ever suffered the emotion of sacrifice in a literal sense. He never could, because he had all of you around him. He always felt blessed to be able to share and to be generous. As a kid, his sort of selfishness and generosity could drive us a bit crazy. He was always giving things away. Veggies, fruit, fish, clothes, cans of anything that wasn't bolted down was pretty much given away. He just didn't have that type of personality. He didn't really want or need things. For me, a few sort of unused toys went missing, which I thought I wanted, but didn't. A few extra kids at parties with kids who we didn't really know that well and didn't know why they were there. Mum and Dad had foster kids who shared our home for periods of time. I remember not liking it very much at all. We couldn't quite understand why he was like that, always giving to others. Only later in life did we realise why he and Mum did what they did. How important the lessons of sharing and compassion were to teach us to give to those that had less, to those in trouble or need. I think we'll only really ever know the fraction of his generous acts that he did for others. He was pretty humble. Mum and Dad didn't do it for any agenda or purpose other than to serve. So how would Pops want today celebrated? Well, I don't think he'd want there to be too many sad tears for him. He wasn't a crying sort of a guy. He'd want happy tears if there were going to be any. He'd want it to be a no-frills celebration. Again, if you know him, he wasn't the guy for materials or fancy. He never liked owning stuff. He loved to reuse. He loved to repurpose. He loved freebies. So does Mum, still. We've joked about the coffin. He would look very fondly and beautifully upon that polished mahogany structure and look at it in awe about how beautiful it was, but he would say, what are we going to do with that afterwards? I'd say, Pops, we're going to burn it. He would look up, he'd be astounded and scared. He'd be like, what a shame, I could make that beautiful wood into a table for the kids in the backyard. I could go to Aldi and go and pick up a dozen chairs to sit it under. I'd go and put it under the peach tree, or for my mates, I'd love a beautiful surface like that. I'd recycle it and we can have a nice glass of whiskey and put it on the bar for Christmas Eve. He would never waste. He would always reuse, and he would always think of others how he could repurpose anything. Today, however, he's amongst us in a different way. And Kinga referred to the thank yous, but I think in real terms it's probably not me who would say thank you, but I think Pops would simply say thank you to you. Thank you for everyone letting him have the privilege of being in your lives and the honour of sharing with him, of letting him be who he was and understanding him, for believing that some people are cut from different cloth, and choose to be generous, selfless, and nurturing. And that was his happiness. He would have thanked you all fiercely with a joyous tinkle in his eyes that everyone remembers and that big smile. To Mum, he would have said thank you for sharing his life and journey with him. 53 years is a crazy journey. I think you guys got married. No, well, you were 19, Mum. It's pretty young. And Dad at 24. They left their home country in Sri Lanka with all the uncertainty that it had at the time, migrated to Australia with hope and dreams. Kingaborn's not long afterwards, and me 3 years later. They had almost no possessions except each other. All they wanted was for a better life for their kids. They started in New South Wales, then to Victoria, both found jobs, worked hard, focused on their young family and how to support them, how to gather networks around them, how to enjoy their time. They were eternally grateful for the opportunities Australia provided them. My dad would say, best country in the world, and he truly believed it. Never forget that he was also a radical lefty, loved his Labor Party with a passion, went to all the rallies, loved Bob Hawke more than any man should, I think. His passion was strong. Mum and Dad created a community around them in their home in Aspendale. Celebrations and generosity defined them. They forged forward, nurturing the children and family and community. Mum, you and Dad, you were linked unconditionally by your generosity and selflessness. I can say this truly, he did love you, Mum. Maybe his only flaw, as King has suggested, was how well he showed it. Not the most expressive guy. Even towards the end, he remembered your birthdays and anniversaries, even when he was in the home and seemed not to remember much at all. He always asked Kinga to buy you something special, which he truly meant. And he didn't forget that, which is always something I found as interesting. To his best friend, Reggie, and our second dad, he would say thank you. No closer friend could he have hoped for. You guys are similar in so many ways. The fun you two had together. Always there for King and me. Always finding new ways to give and love. Always interested in what could be done for others and in need. You two had so many stories and shared so many experiences. It's clear you two were the perfect friends to thrive in a new country with shared ambitions and energy. And I know that I am quite sure that you two got up to some crazy mischief in the early days. There's always a twinkle in their eye when you and Reggie and Dad used to talk about their stories together out partying. There's a lovely photo that'll come up after the communion of you two riding an elephant together in Sri Lanka. I can only imagine what you were talking about. I'm sure you'd something like, Chucky boy, we've got our getaway car. Our last chance to get away from the three sisters out of here into the jungle. You can see the smile on both of your face. It was always mischievous. To coin a phrase, Reggie would literally give you the shirt off his back for my dad. Actually, Reggie would give the shirt off his back for anyone. In the slideshow today, most of the shirts Dad wears are from Reggie. He was not a fashion guy. Teased him again, dressed from the Reggie collection. He loved you dearly, Reggie. I know in passing and in the viewing yesterday, Mum chose one of the beautiful shirts that he loved, Dad loved, and that is clearly the one Reggie gave him in the last few years. To our immediate and large family, Dad would have said thank you. Faye, Lorraine, Russ, Steve-O, Daniela, Tris and Jay. Nothing meant more to Dad than family. You've been there from the start, always connected and sharing your passions, garden, sports, fishing, holidays, food, and occasionally Dad's kryptonite subject, politics, just add booze, rarely ended well. I think Steve-O and Russ will agree with that one. Family gave him his best life, never to want or to receive, always to give. He was so excited to be around you. To the cousins and extended family, he would say thank you. You've had the fortune of knowing him since a boy. I'd tease him that he's got more cousins than I've had hot dinners. And as Mum knows, I've had plenty of hot dinners. In truth, I don't really know what a cousin is in Sri Lanka, but he sure had a lot of them, just the way he liked it. And you're all here today, which he would have loved. Your parties, dancing, sing-alongs, baila, hall dances, music, feasts, celebrations, jive bunny, holidays, Everything was non-stop. You did it all. You really did party hard. Kinga and I are very just backing it up. Thursday, Friday, Saturdays, you guys would party. My dad would say thank you for that gift. It made him so happy. Those stories and memories that you made, he bragged about often, and it made me grateful too. To our friends, neighbours and community of Mum and Dad, plus all the friends of Kinga and mine, who got to know Dad over the many years, he would say thank you for enriching his life. Many of you have travelled far to be here. You kept him engaged and fascinated. He loved listening to your journeys, loved breaking bread, watching as the adults and kids changed and grew from year to year, Christmas party to Christmas party. Loved hearing how well you were all doing, how blessed he felt to be surrounded by these amazing friends, neighbours and local community. You would always say just thank you for turning up and talking to him and listening. I have to add a one story because I'm only just adding it because we saw it on the slide yesterday. One of the boys reminded me of there's a picture of Dad pushing us on the swings. It's a very early story, and I'm saying it because I don't think anybody knows it really. So in the probably late 70s, we were probably 4 and 6 years old. Kinga and I, Mum's place, as you know, in Aspendale, this is a park called Luca Park, which is just behind our house. We used to have some swings and slides and all that sort of carry on there. And Dad used to take us there, maybe to get out of the house for a little while, and to have some fun together. So I'm sure he was daydreaming as he pushed us slowly on those swings, thinking to himself peacefully, when another couple came up behind him. He didn't know who they were, but all he heard was in Sri Lankan or Sinhalese, which he didn't know. There was not many sort of Sinhalese people around at the time. He heard the couple say, "I wonder when this white devil is going to give our daughters a go on these swings." So my dad was, he's quite self-conscious about his whiteness, mainly because nobody ever believed that he was Sri Lankan. He sort of didn't have a sort of standard accent. He was always spending time in the sun, Mum in the shade, Dad in the sun, always trying to get darker. So this Sinhalese couple were behind him, and so he turned around and as Kinga described him, he was always wanting to meet people. So he turned around and in his best Sinhalese said, "Komatha Machang," which I understand, and I'm sorry if I said that wrong, to mean, "Hello friend, how are you?" So poor Auntie Chandra and Uncle Erdley, who had just moved into this area, met the only sort of white Sinhalese fluent guy within probably 1,000 kilometres pushing these olive-skinned kids in the park. Immediately he befriended them. And the beauty of the story is that was Pops. He stayed friends with Erdley and Chandra and the girls. We ended up living 6 houses down. We spent most of our childhood with them after that day. So a chance meeting ended up being a lifelong friendship, which he treasured and valued just by taking the chance to say something funny or kind. They talk about that story. To the staff at Cabrini, he would say thank you. The nurses he described as angels. He was an outdoors guy. He didn't like hospitals, but appreciated the love he was shown through his many admissions. Our family know the length he went to up and beyond. There's some staff here today to care for Dad, which we are eternally grateful. But to his greatest treasure, no doubt, were his grandchildren. No more joy and pride was brought to him. His buoyancy was limitless. His pride overflowed with the special bonds he forged. As you know, there are many, many boys in the Anthonisz clan, and he was very good at looking after boys. But to finally have his special granddaughter Ruby filled his heart, the special connection. I know, Ruby, and you had a very special bond. And the last week before he passed, Ruby visited him in this facility while he was recovering. While I was tired and cynical, questioning what we were doing, he met me downstairs, and after seeing him, he spoke to me, and bright and bubbly as ever, said, "Pops looks fantastic today. He looks so good. He doesn't know where he is, but he is super excited to be up there, and he's sitting with Jack now." Your positivity lifted my spirits that day, Ruby. I didn't truly believe you. When I went upstairs, he was sort of quiet, his quiet self again. But what's beautiful is on the second last photo that we'll show today is that moment that Pops had with Jack. And he is alive. He's the Pops of old. He was excited and vibrant. And as Kinga said, loves being around kids. It was such a special gift to capture that last photo of him. To the kids, you know, Pops, you loved learning, loved being a nerd, loved sport, loved nature, loved animals. And I think that grandchildren's passion for those areas, thinking animals outdoors, will live through him. I hope they get most of his genes and most of his lovely traits. I'm still not sure who will get his party animal gene yet, but that might skip a generation, maybe. Maybe, hopefully. You all share his nature. I think you've got his ability to smile through your eyes. It's quite beautiful for us. We can see it every day. To Lucy and Vic, to have intelligent and kind daughters in his home was more than he could have hoped for. Your softness and intuition invaluable. Kinga and I are not the most emotionally intelligent blokes in the world, and we can blame Dad for that. But Pops would say thank you to Vic and Lucy for making Kinga and I always feel like we made the right decisions, even when most of the time it was probably both of your ideas in the first place. And to those whom Pops or myself forgot to mention, he would say sorry. But thank you for being in his wonderful life. Lastly, from Kinga and I to Dad, we say thank you for the opportunities, the sacrifices, the unwavering positivity and support, for Mum and Dad smothering us with love and food, for going through life making us feel that we had everything a child could want, for making us feel like we were special, for teaching us to believe in ourselves and to always know there's more in giving than receiving. We will try and live by your values. Maybe it won't come across as easy as you both seem to do it, but as an aspiration, we'll hopefully pass this on through to our children. Thanks, Dad.
Thank you, Brian. Thank you, Kingsley, for those words. Again, to capture the life of Kingsley, and no doubt we all have the opportunity to share some stories with refreshments after the Mass today. So we continue with our Mass and some more storytelling from our scriptures that talk about this final journey that Kingsley undertakes. So let us pray. God of life, you have loved Kingsley into life and drawn him deeper into your love. We give thanks for him and honour him as a loving and nurturing husband, father, grandfather and friend. Welcome him to eternal life and look kindly on Phyllis and their family gathered around him today that they may be sustained in peace and love. And we ask this through Christ our Lord. I'd like Lucy to come forward to lead us in our first reading.
A reading from the book of Ecclesiasticus. God sets the time for birth and the time for death, the time for dying and the time for healing, the time for tearing down and the time for building. God sets the time for sorrow and the time for joy, the time for mourning and the time for dancing, the time for embracing and the time to refrain. God sets the time for finding and the time for losing, the time for saving and the time for throwing away, the tearing and the time for mending, the time for silence and the time for talk. God sets the time for love and the time for hate, the time for war and the time for peace. What do we gain from all our work? I know the heavy burdens that God has laid on us. He has set the right time for everything. He has given us a desire to know the future, but never gives us the satisfaction of fully understanding what he does. So I realised that all we can do is be happy and do the best we can while we are still alive. All of us should enjoy what we have worked for. It is God's gift. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I invite Vicky to lead us in our Psalm 23.
One says, the Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing else I want.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. Fresh and green are the pastures where he gives me repose. Near restful waters he leads me to revive my drooping spirit.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
He guides me along the right path. He is true to his name. If I should walk in the valley of darkness, no evil would I fear. You are there with your crook and your staff. With these you give me comfort.
As my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
You have prepared a banquet for me in the sight of my foes. My head you have anointed with oil, my cup is overflowing.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
Surely goodness and kindness shall follow me all the days of my life. In the Lord's own house shall I dwell for ever and ever.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
Please stand to welcome the gospel. Alleluia, alleluia,
alleluia.
Happy are those who have died in the Lord. Let them rest from their labours, for their good deeds go with them. Alleluia.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God still and trust in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house. If there were not, I would have told you. I am going now to prepare a place for you, and after I've gone and prepared you a place, I shall return to take you with me, so that where I am, you may be too. You know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said, "Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Let's all be seated. It's interesting, at least for me, when we venture into a cemetery, and I don't think that most of us do that every day. I sort of do that every now and then, but that's me. We read the headstones that have written the name and the birth date and a death date, and usually there's a dash in between, a bit like the dash in between the birth date and the death date there on the screen. I'm always amazed when I head to the older section of the cemetery and you read the dates that go back a century or so. We don't know how these people's lives were lived, but someone or some people did back in those days. We heard Kingsley read this beautiful poem titled "What Will Matter?" Very poignant, cuts to the chase. There's another poem titled, actually, "The Dash," which also highlights the importance of how we are remembered. And again, not about the amount of assets or the notoriety or prestige that we achieve during our lives, but maybe more so about the qualities of generosity, selflessness, forgiveness and love that one expressed in their lives. So hopefully the dash that is our lives contains more of them than the first list that I read out. So we have heard in those eulogies about the many ways that Kingsley Anthonisz Sr. lived his dash as a loving man who put energy into his family's faith and his friends. And there are many acts of generosity that we espouse of today in the stories shared, but there are many acts that will be buried with Kingsley and only God knows them. And it's now to this God that we hand Kingsley over to. Yes, the body itself will come to its final end, but the soul lives on in the heart of God. Kingsley lived out his passions for fishing, gardening, love of birds. He lived his truth and brought joy to many. And his love extended to the most important people in his life, in particular Phyllis, his wife, two boys that they brought into the world. And his love continued to be shared when daughters-in-law appeared, only to reach a pinnacle when the grandchildren appeared. I sense that the grandchildren will hold Pop's memory for a very long time. The first reading from the book of Ecclesiastes talks about there being a time for everything. And so, yes, it is time to say goodbye to Kingsley. Goodbye for people of faith means until we meet again. As we believe that Kingsley's soul will make its final journey to be in complete union with God, and when it is our turn to leave this earth, then we will be united with Kingsley through God's love. The reading captures the rhythm and pattern of earthly life, but it comes to a final climax when our journey reaches our loving God. For us, our time is to honour Kingsley's life by channeling his passion for life and loving as he did. Kingsley's death on Easter Monday was the day after Christians everywhere celebrated the resurrection of Jesus. And we heard in the gospel story of Jesus who was crucified on the cross on that Good Friday, only to rise to new life on Easter Sunday. And God the Father has redefined death as the entry point to new life. Death has a new meaning for the believers, and we are then asked to believe that there is more, even more than what the death date states. The 1st of April is the anniversary of Kingsley's life on earth, but heralds the beginning of that final journey to that mansion in heaven that Jesus tells Thomas in the gospel today. Heaven depicted as a mansion with many rooms in it, and that room is now ready for Kingsley. And the gospel also invites us to not let our hearts be troubled, but to trust in God. And that invitation is there for each and every one of us. It calls us to take a leap of faith, believing in a God that we cannot see or touch or smell or feel, but one who reaches out to us, especially through the sacraments. And the Eucharist offered us today is that link between us and God, and strengthens that link between us and Kingsley. And finally, as we say goodbye, we are consoled that Kingsley will always be successful in his heavenly fishing experiences. There won't be any that will get away. His gardening will always come up roses, and his memory will always be that of his beloved family and friends. And so may the angels welcome you into paradise, and may you rest in peace. Amen. So let us offer our special prayers of intention today, and I'll invite Sam, Tom, Toby, Ben and Ruby and James to come forward to assist us with these prayers of the faithful. Let's all stand together for these our prayers. And so we are gathered today as Kingsley's family and friends to praise God for the life and love he shared with each of us, knowing he is now at peace with God. Let us pray with confidence.
Lord, we thank you for the gift of Pops, a gentle and courageous man whose life reflected strength, humour, loyalty and love. Loved totally by his friends, cherished and respected by his friends. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for Grandma, Pop's beloved wife, and give thanks for the love and devotion they shared. May happy memories sustain her and bring her peace. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Pray for all of our family, Pops' children and grandchildren, who all brought him so much pride and joy. May special memories of love and laughter, strength and courage comfort us, and may Pops' goodness inspire us always to be generous, just and compassionate people. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Pray for those who cared for Pops with kindness and expertise, especially the staff of Whitewater Aged Care Facility and Cabrini Hospital. Lord, may they continue to show your gentleness, respect and compassion to all those who need their care. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the many friends and neighbours who are privileged to share in Pop's life. May they all feel enriched by having known him. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for those who have gone before us who will greet Pop in the risen light. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer. Father, in the resurrection of your Son, you have shown that love is stronger than death. Support us as we continue our journey and look forward to being reunited with Kingsley and all those we have loved. We make all these prayers through Christ our Lord. Let's be seated as Sam and Tom bring us the gifts for our offertory. We join in our offertory hymn, As Gentle as Silence. Let's stand together. Pray, friends, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of God's name, for our good and good of all of God's holy church. Lord, we are united in this sacrament by the love of Jesus Christ. Accept these gifts and receive our brother Kingsley into the glory of your Son, who is Lord forever and ever. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For as one alone he accepted death, so that we might all escape from dying. As one man he chose to die, so that in your sight we all might live forever. And so, in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we say together, Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Feel free to be seated or to kneel. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and, once more giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be passed on to you, poured out for you and for all, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." We join in together the mystery of faith as we say together, when we eat this bread and drink this cup. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and Peter our Archbishop and all the clergy. Remember your servant Kingsley, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who is united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. For it is through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honour is yours forever and ever. Amen. Let's stand together. And in a prayer that we are called to pray together as we call upon for our daily bread, we say, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let's turn to those nearest to us and offer a sign of peace. And we pray together, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Feel free to be seated or to kneel. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. For those who'd like to receive Eucharist, we'll make two lines going down the centre aisle and then just returning back the side aisles. Those who would prefer to receive a blessing, just to indicate that, just come forward with your arms crossed and we'll give you a blessing. And we do have what we call low gluten hosts. If anyone requires that, to please come forward to me for that particular host. Thank you. Loving God, your Son Jesus Christ gave us the sacrament of his body and blood to nurture and guide us on our journey to your kingdom. May our brother Kingsley, who shared in the Eucharist, come to the banquet of life Christ has prepared for us. We ask this through Christ our Lord. The family have put together a lovely visual tribute of Kingsley's life, which they'd like to share with us now. Thank you. Some beautiful images, so thank you to the family for allowing us to see those images that trigger many memories. Come very close to the end of the funeral mass here today. I've got the final concluding rites, and then as we process out, we're all invited to follow and then make our way to the St. Louis School Hall for refreshments. So for those who are not familiar with where that is, just follow the crowd. It won't be far. You don't need to get in your cars. Before we part, let us take leave of our brother Kingsley. May this last farewell express the depth of our love for him, ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. And we know that one day we will be reunited with him, where the love of Christ will overcome even death itself. Let us comfort one another with this faith in Jesus Christ. Earlier in the Mass, we used the baptismal symbols. Bless the coffin with the holy water. We believe at baptisms when we receive the Holy Spirit, and we now honour the body that is Kingsley, who allowed the Holy Spirit to live and reside within and to guide him in life. So as a way of showing that reverence and honouring, we do so with the incensing of the coffin as a sign of respect, and also may the smoke that rises be symbolic of our prayers. May they rise to meet him in heaven. I do invite you to join in the next three of our special prayers. Saints of God, come to his aid. Come to meet him, angels of the Lord. Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High. May Christ, who called you, take you to himself. May angels lead you to Abraham's side. Give Kingsley eternal rest, O Lord, and may your light shine on him forever. Could I invite us all to be upstanding? O God, author and sustainer of our lives, our final home, we commend Kingsley to you. Trusting in your mercy and in all your embracing love, we pray that you give him happiness forever. Turn also to us who have suffered this loss. Strengthen the bonds of this family and our community. Confirm us in faith, in hope, and in love, so that we may bear your peace to one another and one day stand together with Kingsley and all the saints in your heavenly kingdom. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Kingsley, may the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you into the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. Eternal rest grant to Kingsley, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. May he rest in peace. May his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. And may the love of God and the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ bless and console you and gently wipe every tear from your eyes. Amen. And may Almighty God bless us all in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So in peace, let us carry Kingsley to his place of rest.
Somewhere over the trees of green and red roses too. I watch them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Well, I see skies of blue and I see clouds of white and the brightness of day. I like the dark and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people passing by. I see friends shaking and singing, how do you do? They really say, I love you. I hear babies cry and I watch them grow. They'll learn much more than we'll know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Someday I wish upon a star, wake up where the clouds are far behind. Be where trouble melts like a lemon drops, high above the chimney top, that's where you find. Lemon drops high above the chimney top, that's where